Good morning, Grounded Community Church. Happy Easter to you today.
Yes, good morning.
It has been a while since we've been up here. But if you forget, my name is David. And beside me is my beautiful baby mama, gorgeous queen, wife, and her.
My name is Christine, and we are absolutely thrilled to have you all here today. So get ready for an electrifying morning with an inspiring message ahead.
Speaking of message, Pastor Mario is going to have a really, really good message today that's going to go straight to the heart. And it kind of, if you kind of think about it, it's a day that we should celebrate because Jesus has risen, right? It's not all about eggs. It's not all about, you know, that kind of stuff. But of course, we're still going to have a kid egg extravaganza full of surprises, including money. Just kidding. I don't know if there's not any money, so parents, good luck. But speaking of surprises, it kind of takes us back to, you know, back in the day during Jesus' time when disciples, you know, got to the tomb mm-hmm. and Mary, and they found that it's all empty. And next thing they're like, Jesus is risen. He's alive.
Yes, exactly. So let's pray that today you'll join us. You'll encounter the surprise of God's boundless love, his mighty power, and his ever-present presence in your life. Oh, and don't forget, we'd love to have you join us every Monday for prayer and Wednesday for midweek, all on Zoom at 7 p.m. We would really like to see you all there. Plus, stay connected with us through Instagram, Facebook, and YouTube for more awesome updates.
All right, folks. Thank you for coming once again. Get ready to worship and let's pour our hearts and open our hearts to God. Let's do this.
Let's do this.
He stood as the first among us, the first to truly see us, to engage with us, to share in our joy and sorrow. With him, we were more than just nobodies. We were valued and understood. His words painted a vivid picture of a new world, a kingdom awaiting us. But then it all fell apart. We were the last to see him alive. Now they were headed to us too. On Friday, we prepared spices. Saturday, we spent in waiting. Now as Sunday morning dawns, we're almost there. But as we get closer, something's off. A strange feeling creeps over us as we draw near.
He's risen forever. Take a seat, shake the hand of the person beside you and say good morning. Well, today, traditionally, we will call it the Christendom celebrates it as the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we titled our message this morning, He is Risen, Jesus is Alive. Now, we had some controversy recently over at Washington, D.C. Well, the President of the United States have proclaimed that today is the Transgender Visibility Day, something like that. Well, for me, I don't mind, because we who are Christians believe that Christ is risen regardless of what they say. Can we say amen? He is risen indeed. In fact, in Luke chapter 24, verse 1 to 5, the Bible said this. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. And they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. So while they were wondering about this, suddenly two men clothed that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground, but the man said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead?" Let's bow our heads for a moment. Father, we thank you once more, O God, regardless of what the world is saying or proclaiming, O God, about this day. Today is your day. Because this is the day, traditionally in the Christian world, that your Son rose from the grave. And because of that, O Lord, He is alive forevermore. And we, your children, celebrate it, O God, because one day we will be with you forever, alive forevermore as well. We bless your name. All glory belongs to you, Father God. In Jesus' name we pray. And that would you say, amen and amen. So no person hearing about the story of the resurrection can possibly be more skeptical, of course, than the apostles. Because if you look at it, they were the ones who were there with Jesus when he was crucified on the cross. And so when they're saying that Jesus is crucified, and I mean, he's risen, they saw him. They saw him get buried on a tomb that was borrowed. But once he started to show himself up to them, they realized he is indeed alive. Now, you and I, we have not seen Christ personally. I wish I could. But one day we will, in eternity, together with our Emmanuel. And so, whatever was the proclamation that is happening out over at Washington, D.C., whatever is happening now all over the world, one thing is certain. And sure, that traditionally today is the day that the Lord rose from the grave. And so we celebrate that. Now, once he had shown himself to them, he went to the length of eating with them. Now, ghosts do not eat food. Have you seen a ghost? Look at the person beside you. No. If you have not seen it, of course, because the disciples, when Jesus was walking on water almost 3 in the morning, it was a storm, and they said they were scared because they thought he was a ghost. So if that statement in the Bible saying that there's a ghost, well, probably we think it's a ghost. But then again, of course, in the Bible, there are more the spirits that or demonic spirits that are trying to take you away from what is true, that Jesus is alive. Resurrection Day was not just Christ being raised from the grave, but to fulfill the promise of God, because in our world, we are taught that if it sounds too good to be true, it probably isn't. If it sounds good to be true, it probably isn't. So many of us have been taken in by empty promises. How many have said a promise to you and they have not fulfilled it? How many of you made a promise that you did not fulfill? I did. And so many of us are taken by empty promises that were distrustful of anything or anyone that tells us that we can have something for nothing. Well, the world simply doesn't work that way. There is nothing free in this world. In everything, there is a catch. No matter, the truth of the matter is that the world is full of empty promises. Like when you're watching TV, or you're on social media, you would find that there are ads that will tell you that if we buy this, or we do this, or we choose this, we can be happy. We can be set. God gave us emptiness that is full of promises. I say it again. God gave us emptiness that is full of promises. That's the reason why he is risen. Why is there promises, emptiness that is full of promises? Well, because the first thing that we need to understand, when Jesus rose from the grave, the tomb is empty. Emptiness full of promises. The tomb. Angels proclaiming that he's alive, glowing like lightning, standing beside the women. And listen to what they said in Luke chapter 24, verse 6 to 8. He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, be crucified, and on the third day, could you read, be raised again. Then they remembered his words. Jesus had risen, he was alive, and he is alive. The tomb was empty, and what a tremendous promise that holds for you and for me. I've been a Christian for quite some time. And then, before I became one, we only know Jesus here. We only know his name. In fact, back in the Philippines, they even have a curse word together with, complete with, Jesus, his mother, and his father. And it's shorted like this, Sus Mari Josep. Probably for Filipinos, you know that Sus Mari Josep is Jesus Maria Joseph. But it became an expression and so on. So the stone was thrown away from the door, not to permit Christ to come out, but to enable the disciples to go in. The stone was open so that we can come in and see that the tomb is empty. By the way, for those who have been to Italy, every year, thousands of people climb a mountain in the Italian Alps, passing the stations of the cross to stand at an outdoor crucifix. I've been to Parma, I've been to Pisa, I've been to Florence. I've seen the places, and I've seen so many beautiful domes of their churches. But there is something that is very different. That in those domes and the churches, when you enter in, Christ is still crucified on the cross. You can see the cross here is empty because the Jesus that we know is alive. He's already risen from the dead. From death, he's already with God in eternity, in heaven interceding for us. So, in that Italian Alps, one tourist noticed a little trail that led beyond the cross, because every year, pilgrims would go to the station of the cross, and this, he fought through the rough thicket, and to his surprise, came upon another shrine, a shrine that symbolized the empty tomb. It was neglected. The brush had grown up around it. Almost everyone has gone as far as the cross, but there they stopped. Up to today, people still see a cross that Jesus Christ is still hanging on that cross. Far too many have gotten to the cross and have known the despair and the heartbreak. Far too few have moved beyond the cross to find the real message of Easter, that this is the message of the empty tomb. For in the fact of the empty tomb is the truth of the resurrected and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And a promise to everyone of us that we too one day will be raised to eternal life. And how do we know that? Again, the Bible is replete with message that God will one day take us home. As we read Romans chapter 6, verse 5 to 8. The Bible said this, since we have been united with him in his death, we also will be raised as he was. Our old sinful selves were crucified with Christ so that sin, could you read, might lose its power in our lives. We are no longer slaves to sin. For when we died, verse 7 said, with Christ, we were set free from the power of sin. And since we died with Christ, we know we will also share his new life. There's a saying that if you are born once, you die twice. Was it dying twice? One, you die in the physical. And second, you die in the spiritual. That heaven is not your home. Hell will be. But once you are born twice, as they say, you're born as in the flesh, and then you're born in the spirit, as they call in John chapter 3. If you're born again, you only die once. Which death? That's the physical death. And in this room, all of us, 1:1, the ratio of death has not changed at all. Death will come to everyone that is in this room today. One day, I don't know when, but one day it will come. But sadly, if we're not Christians, if we have not embraced the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ, or Jesus Christ being Savior, we will die the second death. And it's called eternal damnation. But thank God for the resurrection. Because Jesus rose from the grave, one day you and I will also rise from death. Those who know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, know Christ as their Lord and Savior, death has lost its sting. It is no longer something to be feared. What fear is there when we have the promise that one day we will live forever with Him in heaven? The tomb is empty. God's way of saying is, relax, my child. I took the sting. Death can't hurt us anymore. About 1930, the communist leader Bukharin journeyed from Moscow to Kiev. His mission was to address a huge assembly. His subject, atheism. For a solid hour, he aimed his heavy artillery at Christianity, hurling argument and ridicule. At last, he was finished and viewed what seemed to be the smoldering ashes of men's faith. Are there any questions? He shouted. A solitary man arose and asked permission to speak. And he was given, and he mounted the platform and moved close to the communist. The audience was breathlessly silent as the man surveyed them from left to right. At last he shouted the ancient Orthodox greeting, "Christ is risen." The vast assembly arose as one man, and the response came crashing like the sound of an avalanche. "He is risen indeed." The resurrection is not only good news, it is the best news imaginable, but it doesn't end there, for there is one more promise that I want you to know about Easter as we listen to this song, "We Believe."
We believe that He conquered death. We believe in We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's giving us new life. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's giving us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered. He's coming back again. He's coming back again. We
believe. Again, in fact, we believe that the tomb is empty. And you know the reason why he's risen? The second point I would like to leave you this morning, the reason why the resurrection is important is he's risen because the burial clothes are empty. Well, if you know, for we have had some deaths recently, one of the husband that passed on, he was buried in his military uniform. And when I saw that, I said, wow. Jesus Christ was buried in a cloth, a shroud. And his head was covered so that it will not be seen because of the goriness of what he received with the crown of thorns and so on. And he was beaten and punched and so on. And when that day came, the disciples saw that aside from the tomb is empty, the burial clothes are empty. In John chapter 30, verse 3 and 9, 20, verse 3 and 9, let's read. The Bible said, so Peter and the other disciples started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Verse 6 says, then Simon Peter, who was behind him, arrived and went into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the burial cloth that had been around Jesus' head. The cloth was folded up by itself, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciples who reached the tomb first also went inside. He saw and believed. Verse 9 said, they still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Now, if you would steal a body, you would steal the entirety of the body, you do not remove the clothes and fold it and leave it on the coffin. You take it all. That's why those who were saying that this body was stolen, it was not. He rose from the grave. That's why, as he rose from the grave, he folded the empty clothes that he was wearing. The head, he folded it neatly. It was lying there. Verse 6 says, he saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the burial cloth. And the cloth was folded up by itself, separate from the linen. There's one 3-year-old, Nicole, was anxious for Easter to come. And as she had been for Christmas to come, and as the family stopped the store to buy her a new pair of shoes to go with her outfit, she once again said, I can't wait for Easter, Daddy. And I asked her, the father said, do you know what Easter means, honey? And she replied, yes. The father asked, well, what does Easter mean? So when I ask you, what does Easter mean to you? In her own sweet 3-year-old way, with arms raised, and a smile on her face, and on top of her voice, she said, surprise! Jesus is alive. What better word could sum up the meaning of Easter? Surprise death? Surprise sin? Surprise mourning disciples? Surprise modern man? I am alive! Surprise! So back to our story. The angel had spoken to the women, And they immediately went back to the pastor's report of what had happened. I mean, if you see good news, what would you do? The first thing that you do is run and share the good news to loved ones and friends. That's what the women did. They ran to the disciples who were cowering in fear because they're afraid that next they might be the next to be crucified. So with this incredible news, Peter and John immediately ran back to the tomb to see for themselves. When they got there, John stopped outside the tomb. So we asked ourselves, why didn't he go in? Please remember, John was the apostle that was at the foot of the cross when Jesus finally gave up his spirit. But before that, he said, son, he's your mother. Mother, he's your son. And for John, that was so intimate and so painful to see and to know that the Lord, the Master that he knew for 3.5 years, is about to go and leave him. And so when he got to the tomb, he dared not look into because he doesn't want to see the body. But then he was curious because the women said it was empty. Probably at the back of his mind, he was saying, did people steal his body? Where would they place them? And so, as he ran there, Peter ran right through, past him. It didn't take long to discover that the tomb was just the way the women had said. It was empty. But as at all, inside Peter found the clothes that Jesus had been buried in. They too were empty. They were folded neatly. And this could only mean one thing. Jesus was alive. If someone had stolen the body, they wouldn't have removed the burial clothes and folded them up neatly and left them where they lay. They could have just run out with the body together with all the burial clothes. But why is the burial clothes folded neatly? It's just for you to I to see that Jesus is in control. Even with the time that he rose from the grave, that he had time to fold his clothes. He was trained well by his parents. He folded his clothes. And so Easter is a feast and is celebrated as the feast of freedom. Easter is God's protest against death. Easter is the feast of freedom and death from death. So we must keep both things together. Easter is triumph over death. It wouldn't be long before Jesus himself would appear to all the apostles and eventually to over 500 people and to Thomas. You know, Thomas, we have a name before him, Doubting Thomas, the disciple who didn't believe and said, unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put the finger where the nails were and put my hands in his side, I will not believe it. Unless I touch it, unless I see the scars in his hands, unless I put my hand on the wound in his side, I wouldn't believe. How many of us one time, our children, our parents came to us and told us a very wonderful news? And you couldn't believe it. Probably we have a child that is, you know, kind of rowdy and kind of, you know, a little crazy. And one day he comes back and he said, Daddy, I've been voted the most improved student in class today. Would you believe that? And probably we say, You? Really? Most improved child in school? You? Really? I have a brother, his name is Paul, the name Apostle Paul. I was down in Manila. I was reviewing for accountancy and reviewing. And in that time that I was in Manila, I started to pray before God that the Lord would reach out and touch the hearts of my brothers and sisters back home in Baguio. I pray that God will move mountains, because the Bible said, even if you have a faith as a mustard seed, if you believe that the mountains will be moved, it will be moved. So I believed it, and I pray, God, touch the lives of my brothers and my sisters and my parents and my cousins and so on in Baguio. In the middle of our review, I was studying. I was sitting down on the bed, and I heard footsteps running up the stairs. We were on the second floor. Running up the stairs. And for those who are familiar with Manila, there's a street there called España. And the apartment was on that part of Manila, and I was studying, and I hear footsteps climbing up. And then I waited for a head to pop out of the door, and he peeps. And I look at him and says, "Oh, Paul, what are you doing here?" And he comes to me, and he sits down beside me, and he said, "Kuya," or "brother, I am now a Christian." When he said that, I just cried. I cried my heart out, because here was my brother. In fact, he was one of the black sheep of the family, aside from me. He was one of the black sheep of the family. And he said, "I'm a Christian." And we embraced and we cried. And we couldn't stop crying, because, and I asked him, "How did you become a Christian?" You know what he said? "I was sitting down at Burnham Park, and my life is going crazily awry. I don't know what I was about to do. I was thinking about committing suicide." We didn't know about that. He only shared that to us after he became a pastor like me. And he said, "We were contemplating suicide. I was contemplating suicide." And suddenly, a beautiful girl came and sat down beside me. A beautiful girl. And started to talk to me and share the gospel to me. And was saying, "Do you know Jesus?" And I looked at her, I'll paraphrase, and he said, "Yes, I know him. But do you believe in him as a savior?" And he said, "No, because I sense that there's something that's happening in you. Would you like to pray with me?" And that beautiful girl led him into prayer to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And he prayed at that very moment at Burnham Park, God moved in his heart. He was saved. And guess what? He was the first one to become a pastor than me. Why is it possible? Because Jesus is alive. Unless, Thomas said, "I touch the hands, I see the marks. Unless I touch the side, I will not believe." But that woman didn't show Jesus, but he spoke about Jesus. That's the reason why Jesus had to appear to this man named Thomas. In John chapter 20, verse 26-28, the Bible said, a week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, now let's put ourselves in the shoes of Thomas that morning. Let's put ourselves as doubters, and Jesus calls out your name. Read with me. Then he said, and then say your name. Then he said to Mario, "Put your finger here, see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it on my side. Stop doubting and believe." And look at verse 28, Thomas said, "My Lord and my God." In fact, they didn't include the next verse. It says, Jesus said, "Blessed are those who did not see but still believe." I have not seen Jesus in person, but I believe that he is Savior. He is risen, and he will come again one day. Think about the cross. It couldn't hold him. It's empty. Think about it, that the tomb couldn't contain him. The burial clothes were unnecessary when he was risen, because Jesus is alive. And he talked and touched and loved and healed. And he did it the day of his resurrection. And he still does still today. He reaches out to those who are in need of him. And most importantly, he wants to touch your heart today. We often forget that the ultimate healing for a Christian is the resurrection. The one that differentiates every religion from Christianity. Christianity is the only one that its leader is alive forevermore. Lou Little was a famous football coach at Columbia University in New York from 1930 to 1956. He led Columbia to a victory in the 1934 Rose Bowl over Stanford University. But first, Lou Little coached at Georgetown University from 1924 to 1929. While he was there, he coached a young man who had all the physical abilities, but not the athletic talent. He needed to be smarter or to be a starter in the team. He worked with the boy every day, but the young man showed no improvement. Despite this, the young man continued to work harder, maintaining a good attitude and spirit regardless. A couple of days before his final game at Georgetown, the young man's father died. And Coach Little told the young man how sorry he was for his loss and that he should go home to be with his family. You can imagine Little's surprise when he got to the locker room the day of the game and found the young man sitting there begging the coach to let him play in the game. "Son," Coach Little said, "you have never been a starter. This is the championship game. I cannot take that kind of risk today." "Coach," he said, "I have to do this for my father." The young man pleaded, "Just put me in for the first play, and then you can take me out of the game." What would you, Lou Little do? Little finally gave in. He could not. How could he not trust his player just this once to play for his father? So he put the young man in the starting lineup, who ran down the field to cover the game's opening kickoff. He tackled the player, returning the kick so hard, he nearly knocked him into the first row of the seats. That's how passionate he was the first game. As the play was over, the young man, as promised, ran to the sideline, knowing he successfully completed the one play the coach promised. Instead, Coach Little motioned for the young man, to stay in the game. So, what did the young man do? The young man played the rest of the game, leading the team in tackles and helping Georgetown win the conference championship. So what does this matter? After the game, Little pulled the young man aside and he said, "Son, where in the world did that come from?" he asked him. "You've never played like that before. You've never shown that much desire in 4 years." And this is what the young man said, "Coach, you know, my father died. And my father was blind. They never knew it. Today," he said, "was the first time he could see me play." You know why? Because he knew that his father was with God in heaven and that God has given him his eyes. And so he said, "This was the first day that my father saw me play." It is because of the resurrection vision that we're able to play above our heads in the game of life and see the purposes and the power and love of God. That's the reason why in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, the Bible said, "Praise be to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In His mercy, He has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the grave." There's a reason why this morning I pray that as we sing the next songs together, we sing it from our heart, believing that Jesus indeed is alive. Let's stand with us this morning as we sing. Thank you.
was a wretch, I remember who I was. I was lost, I was blind, I was running out of time. Sin separated, the breach was far too wide. From the far side of the chasm, you held me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide. Left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid a debt I owe. Broke my chains, freed my soul. For the first time I had hope. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood of life. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glorious light. Laid inside my tomb of sin. You were buried for 3 days, but then you walked right out again. And now death has no sting, and time has no end. For I have been transformed by the blood of the Lamb. Thank you, Jesus.
The blood of thy Lord.
His name.
And Father, we thank you for this day. Indeed, your Son is alive forevermore. Lord, we stand before you, God Almighty, knowing, O Lord God, that the tomb is empty, the burial clothes are empty, and your promises that are empty are full of promises, Father, because Jesus Christ is alive forevermore. We pray, Father God, today for those who are still doubting about Christ, Savior, Redeemer. We pray, Father God, that it would just penetrate our hearts to know, Father God, that you sent him to die for our sins. And as we believe and accept that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior, we are called your children. Father God, thank you. I pray, Father God, for every person in this room today. I pray, God, that you will touch them from the top of their heads to the soles of their feet, Father God. That as they leave this building this morning, that they experience, oh God, a divine moment that they have seen and heard and have been touched by your presence. We thank you, Father God, that it would change their lives, that forevermore they would believe that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior, and that he is risen, and that one day he will come again to take us home for eternity. I pray, Father God, that your grace be evident, O God, for every family represented here, as you sustain us, Father God, every day of our lives. Lord, you gave your Son, and our thankful spirit, Father God, as we also celebrate with Resurrection Sunday, we celebrate, Father God, as we offer our tithes, our offerings to you, that you alone be given glory and honor, Father. Lord, we pray that, Lord, as we have fellowship later on, and as the children would have Easter egg celebration this afternoon, Father God, keep everyone safe and have fun and family, and this, the food that will be shared, may it be a blessing for our bodies, Father God. Thank you once more as we continue to honor and worship you, Father God, for you are indeed risen. Jesus, indeed, you are alive. We love you. This we pray in Jesus' name. Everyone would say, amen and amen. You're going to begin. Let's sing once more.
Thank you for such a powerful message this morning. Why don't you take your seats first? Okay, so again, what a powerful message today. He is risen indeed.
Amen.
Amen. Yes. So as we continue our celebration today, actually as you came in the lobby, you see there's food over there. So don't worry. But again, before that, I'd like to announce again, just like David and Jean had said earlier, on Mondays, at 7 p.m., we have our prayer meeting via Zoom. And same thing on the midweek service at 7 p.m., we have our midweek service at 7 p.m. via Zoom. If you want to join us, just come see me or anybody of church. We can give you the passcode for our Zoom meetings. That way you could actually have us and continue with the fellowship with us. So again, for this afternoon, before we actually have the activities for the kids, we'll have lunch first. And then as we continue to have lunch, we'll prepare the place for the after-service activity for the children. We actually had reserved the park, but since it's already started raining, we decided it's actually safer to have it over here inside this building. So again, we thank you for joining us here at Grounded Community Church. We hope to see you again, not only for this coming Monday and Wednesday and Sunday, but for the rest of the Sundays to come. We'd like to have fellowship with you. If you want to know more about Grounded Community Church, please approach me or anybody from here, and we'd like you to introduce you to the church, and we'd like to welcome you to join us actually as a member. Again, if you could please rise up and join our worship team as we close in song. Thank you very much.
Heaven's lost its victory, and the grave has been denied. Jesus lives forever, he's alive. He's alive, he's the Alpha and the
last is He. The curse of sin is broken. We have perfect liberty.
Yes.
The Lamb of God, as we sing, He's alive. He's alive. Oh, 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 hallelujah. Oh, 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 hallelujah. Jesus, be lifted higher. We serve a risen Savior. Reason, He's risen, forever glorified. Reason, He's risen, King Jesus. King Jesus is risen, He's risen, forever glorified. Reason, He's risen, King Jesus is alive. King Jesus is alive. King Jesus is alive.
Come through the door, then come back in through the back. Thank you very much.